Let's turn to the book of Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne. Now here was the king that was the greatest king in all that region. Built the most powerful army. And our army was always, that's why you see other nations with kingdoms. They always portray their army and go and show those parade of all their war material. Because they want to show their subjects in their nation that they have the material to protect them. Uzziah had everything. But all of a sudden, Uzziah is dead. And this young man, Isaiah, was close and dependent upon Uzziah, trusted in Uzziah. If you would want to call it codependence. Knew it was nothing greater than him. Now he is not there no more. Have you ever had somebody that was great to you that you just seemed like you couldn't live without them? I mean, if they were not happy, you wasn't happy. If they was happy, you got happy just to see them happy. That's some people like that. You can fix your hair. You don't like the way they don't like your hair. You don't like your hair no more. You can be so codependent on another person's approval till you can't even find God's place in you in him. Because when you trust God, God will show you there are greater things than you imagine in your own mind. But when Uzziah died, he saw the Lord. Now look how it explains it though. When the king Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting up on a throne, high and lifted up. You see, King Uzziah sat on the throne too. Every king sat on a throne. But when he came to his end, when the man he looked to, trusted in, was no longer there, he couldn't see him. He gone. He even believed Uzziah when he was sick. It was only till he died he had trusted Uzziah would come out of that sickness. But that leprosy took him on away. But when he died, this young boy was trouble. But it caused him to see a greater king. And God just didn't let this young man see a king. He saw him sitting on a throne. God was letting us, this prophet Isaiah, know you're worried about where Uzziah is and who else can help you and who else got an army. I want you to look up and see I'm sitting higher than Uzziah and I'm sitting on a throne, and that's what you need to do. Stop holding your head down. Stop being sad as if you got nobody to meet your petition. There's a God in heaven. If you only look up, he can move you out of this condition. He can move you. Saw him sitting high. And not only that, his train filled the temple. Let me tell you something. Uzziah, you ever seen these brides come in and they had them big wide train? And you might see them cover so much of the aisle. Well, when a king came in, he had a robe on too when he showed his king. And his robe might be as wide sometimes as some of these brides' wives. Bride's dresses just cover a little spot. But when Isaiah looked up and saw this king, that king train filled that whole temple. That whole temple. You're talking about a big old robe of righteousness, robe of glory, a robe of honor. It filled the entire temple. All of a sudden, this man is recognizing, I'm not in as bad a shape as I think I am. I don't have to throw in the towel. I don't have to feel I can't make it. Because mama gone. Daddy gone. Wife gone. Children gone off left. Nobody love you no more. But all, if I can get you to be like this man, stop going around with your head hung down. Stop going around murmuring and complaining on the phone to this and that. Look up like this prophet did. He looked up toward heaven and God let him see something. God wants you to see he's still on the throne. You say, I'm sick. He's still on the throne. I just lost my job. He's still on the throne. My husband just left. He's still on the throne. I don't know how I'm going to make it. He's still on the throne. Shout glory to God, somebody. It ain't over. What does it mean, the king on the throne? Do you know what that really means? You live in a democracy. You don't know what that means. What that means, a king always sat on his throne for judgment. People always brought petitions to the king. King, I need land to raise my cow. Grant him 2 acres. King, I need land to feed my 25 cows. Grant him 100 acres. King, I don't have enough money to get my medicine. Give him the medicine from such and such. The king ordered everybody's life from his throne. He made sure his whole kingdom moved and reigned with joy and happiness, and their necessities were made. That's what the king did. The king could order your death if you seem to be rebellious or contrary to him from the throne, because he set in order rules and laws. Every king has rules in. Every king has law. I don't care. You will not find one kingdom that don't have a law. King determined what language you speak. We saw in America, king came over here. 3 kings came over here. One took the western coast, the Spanish king. All those folks out there had to start speaking Spanish, even though they were Indians. Because the king of Spain took it. We find the British took a portion of this land on the eastern coast, and everybody on the eastern coast had to start speaking English and eating the British food, following the British laws. We find a king took over central United States. France, people in Louisiana had to start speaking French. Told them what to eat. So when you are under kingdom, we talk about the kingdom of God. My next question to you is, are you obeying the king? Did the king tell you to cuss your Wi-Fi? Did he tell you every out of word you speak, you're giving account of? Do you believe the king? The king orders his laws. This king we have is a king of righteousness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Did you know when you was in the kingdom, you were even named after the king? Did you know most of our names in America, we got British names? We're not named, you don't find Browns and Johnsons coming out of Africa. Even we came from Africa, your name had to be changed. Why do you think the folks in Louisiana have French names? They didn't just choose to do that. It was a king told them and named them how they ought to be named. Every one of you in here that have come to Jesus and made him your Lord, you ought to be called by his name. That's why he said, my people are called by my name. Humble themselves. He said, all you got to do, if you've been wrong, if I can get you just to humble yourself. He's not a king coming to kill you. He's not a king wanting to put you in hell. He's a king wanting you to have life, but you got to humble yourself. And you shall be exalted. He said, my people called by my name will humble themselves and pray. He said, seek my face. Turn from their ways. Then I would hear from heaven. Well, you might say, so-and-so made me mad. So-and-so got on my nerve. So I had to tell him off. Is that what God said you do? See, I told you, thoughts are building blocks of character. You've been thinking about how you need to tell somebody off. You've been thinking about what they need to do different. And now time you get the opportunity, you're ready to tell them off and you can lose your position. You'll always honor your father and mother. God has said your days be long. He said a son curses father and mother shall die to death. I'm not here to put you down. See, you don't want to hear me preach. I know you don't like this here. But I'm trying to show you how you can get in touch with this king. The son that cusses his father, mother, the Bible said they should die to death. What is cussing your father, mother? Go to talking nasty about them, dirty about them. You don't have to use the vulgar words to cuss your father, mother. The Bible said you can say reikai, which is a vain person, when you put bad titles on somebody. That's cursing them. Did you know David got cursed out by his friend by calling him a bloody man? Do you take honor for speaking negative to the elders? Do you think that's showing your manhood? Do you think that's showing? Why did Jesus turn his cheek to the one that smit him? Why did Paul turn around and apologize when he told a man, God's going to smite you, you whited wall? Paul took this thing back. He repented. You feel justified as long as the person you feel is wrong. I know you don't want to hear me preach, but I got you here now. We're going to start reading here, Acts chapter 16, and let's start here at verse. We're going to go and start from verse. I would like to start up a little early, but I just might tell you the story so you may understand this. This is the time that Paul was put in jail. Paul and Silas was put in jail. And the jailer had gotten a commandment from the magistrates to watch those men. Don't let these men out of your sight. And you will find in this story as I read it, many people read this and misunderstand this whole story because they think the man, when he said, what must I do to be saved? They think the man is talking about what they need to do to go to heaven. But the man is really not talking about what he need to do to be saved, go to heaven. He's talking about what he need to do to be saved from the king's or the magistrate's wrath. Because when he woke up, he found all the jail doors were open. And when anyone had a charge to keep prisoners, if the prisoners got away, your life always went for their life. And your family life was taken. Hallelujah. So now when you read this story, you need to understand this man was not even saved. He really didn't even know nothing about Jesus when he asked, what must I do to be saved? But he had been brought to a position that he was ready, contemplating suicide. Because sometime what he thought in his mind, well, if I kill myself, when they come and find all the prisoners gone and they see me dead, at least they will not kill my family. They will know that, well, they overpowered him somehow and they killed him. So these men got out free, and we're not going to do nothing to his family and to his household. But if he'd have stayed there alive and everybody else was gone, then when the magistrates come, they felt he'd let them go, and they would have killed him and all his children. So now let's read this story. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's go to verse number 23. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, talking about Paul and Silas, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. Now, what he did, he knew this was a serious thing that he had to do, so he didn't only put them in jail, he put them in the hole, into the innermost part of the prison, then locked their feet down with chain against post. Make sure these guys don't get out of here. But let me tell you something. When you pray, it's praying, nobody can keep you bound. I don't care how many people try to keep you down. Don't the devil tell you this isn't keeping you down, that isn't keeping you down. No, you're keeping yourself down. If you learn how to pray, God knew how to loose the chains that cannot hold you down. Can I get somebody to shout glory to God? Hallelujah. He cast them in the prison, making sure he keep them safe. Hallelujah. But at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed. It said they sung praises unto God. At midnight, these guys are still up glorifying God. Why are you complaining about everything? That's what I want to know. How you going to see God's glory if you don't learn how to stand still and ask God for his power to show you the way? You can't go out of feelings. These guys didn't feel good. And they knowing God's supposed to be with them, that ain't jail. Locked in the inner court where the bad guys are, the guys on death row be put. But they still find a way to sing praises to God. They didn't just sing a song, but they sung some, oh, how great thou art. They sung songs, Lord, you worthy to be praised. Great is the Lord in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful situation. Hey, they talked about God's greatness and they praised him. They honored him in this condition. My question to you, are you honoring God whatever you're going through at this time? If you don't, you find yourself in trouble. And it said, and the prisoners heard them. That means they wasn't ashamed to get loud with it in jail. They wasn't ashamed. They weren't ashamed to praise God. And you know thoughts went to their mind. Now, these folks are thinking y'all bad. Look at y'all in jail. And God didn't let y'all get in jail. Y'all been preaching about how great God is. Now you in jail. These folks saying ain't nothing to your God. But those people heard them praising God in this. Just people are wondering how you going to still be happy with all what you're going through. How can you still minister? How can you still do the things you do? Because you got a praise on the inside. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prisons was shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and every man's band was loose. All those chains was loose. This show you what prayer would do. Prayer didn't only deliver Paul and Silas. It healed. It opened up the doors for everybody that was in jail. This is when you come go through things in life. God is not only taking you through to bring you out for yourself alone. I'm telling you. He's taking you through these things to bring so you can be a witness and to help others that are in the same predicament to not lose hope. Hallelujah. All the doors were open and every man's band was loose. And when the keeper of the prison awake out of his sleep, seeing the prison doors were open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing the prisoners had been fled. Now, do you understand why he wanted to kill himself? Because he thought the prisoners was gone, and the next thing was for him was that magistrate was going to kill him and every one of his members of his household. So he said, well, I'm fixing to kill myself. This shows you sometimes people are brought to the end of things that they seem like they have no resolve. But look what Paul said. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm. Now let me say to every one of you, when you are hurting and you are in trouble, it seems like you can't see light at the end of this tunnel. Do yourself no harm.